In this video, you will learn how to create this animated image grid. Now I know what you are thinking, what is so special about this? It just looks like a regular CSS grid with some images in it. Well, let's try selecting one of these options now, shall we? I mean, look at that, look how smooth those transitions are. And the best thing about it is that these transitions are relevant to the current state of the image gallery. So there's no stock animations here. The grid pieces itself together based on the images that are currently being displayed and the end result that the user wants to go to. This means that the animation will be different if we decide to go back to the or option from water, and then if we decide to do the very same thing but from earth instead. As you could see, it's a different animation. Another cool feature that is worth mentioning is the fact that if we select a new option before the transition for the option that we have just selected is even finished, then our image gallery will respond to this immediately and begin the according transition without any stuttering or jump cuts to the ending animation state. This is made possible through CSS transitions, which allow us to stop the transition midway through or begin a new transition, and the transition element will simply pick up from where it currently is and not have to jump to its ending state or anything like that. This is in stark contrast to CSS animations, which do not allow us to do this. If we try and stop a CSS animation midway through, then it will simply jump to the end of the animation. This is because CSS animations have both a starting and an ending point, whereas CSS transitions don't, they only have an ending point. We are also animating the height of the gallery based on how many rows we have currently. As you can see, it shrinks when we go from or to something else, and I've added this black footer at the bottom just so that you could see the height difference more clearly. Without this changing height, then our gallery would feel static, and even if the images are moving around, users would be able to tell that something is off with the design, even if they aren't able to initially identify what it is. Also, we won't be using any frameworks like React to create this feature. Instead, we will simply be using the standard HTML, CSS and JavaScript on their own and without any frameworks. So not even things like jQuery or GSAP will be used, because honestly, they are simply not necessary to create something like this. All that is needed is the core tools of front-end web development. And if you want to implement this design of frameworks, then it shouldn't be too hard to translate this tutorial into your framework of choice, because it is not translating from lower levels to higher levels that is difficult. It is translating from higher level to another higher level framework. Now, this highly interactive style of image gallery was based on the image gallery that I am currently using on my portfolio website, which in turn was inspired by the image galleries used on other people's websites. As you can see in this version, we have some extra furnish, where this overlay fades into visibility, accompanied with a button that when we click on it, we see a bigger version of the image, accompanied with some information. Now, you won't be implementing this added touch to our images in this tutorial due to time constraints, but it is still worth mentioning in case you needed guidance on how to improve your image gallery even further after completing this tutorial. Now, obviously in your own version, you can customize things to your liking. Things like colours and images are unimportant. What is important is the core logic required to build an image display as live and interactive as this one, which is why it is the focus of this tutorial. But before we begin the tutorial, let's not forget that this is a responsive design, and the animations adapt flawlessly to whatever size the viewport currently is. And one more thing as well, the code for the completed project will be in the description box below, in case you get stuck at any point during this tutorial, or if you want to see the code in full. So here we are in Visual Studio Code, my source code editor of choice. The only thing that I've done in this new project folder is set up this markup file, along with the accompanying style sheet and JavaScript file, which are linked to in this document. We will start by creating the stock styling that many programmers create whenever they start a new project. All we are doing is removing any margin and padding that browsers may apply to certain elements like paragraphs by default, including these margin and padding values in the elements width and height values. Then we will be including these margin and padding values in the element's width and height values, and then setting the default font family for all the elements. Other than that, we are also preventing the document from being able to be scored horizontally if our elements do indeed overlap our viewport on the x-axis. We do this because it is very unlikely that a website would intentionally want their users to be able to scroll horizontally. They would for the y-axis because that is just scrolling up and down, like a paragraph for example, but not for the x-axis because very few websites do this, and so users may find it uncanny, and therefore it is not good website design. Our entire image gallery will go within the section. We need it to get that height transition when the number of rows in the gallery change that I mentioned at the start of the video. The styling for this is very simple. Using overflow hidden along with a hard-coded height will allow us to smoothly transition the height to the image gallery. Whenever we want to do this, all we need to do is change the height value of this section, and nothing will overlap with the other elements below because we have set overflow to hidden. Speaking of elements below, we will now create this footer element that only really exists to show you that the height is transitioning, so that you don't have to worry about how this image gallery will interact with the rest of your website. If you do decide to use this type of gallery on your own website that has other content besides this image gallery. Again, very simple styling for this. The first thing that we actually do in the gallery section is set the title. Obviously, the text content isn't really important here. In your own project, you can call the section whatever you want. Next comes the image gallery's navbar, where the user can select an option to filter out images based on whether or not they fit the user's chosen category. Here are the different options that the user can select on this navbar. We have created four of them, and one of them is the default option, the option that will be selected automatically on page load where all the images are shown. Now, four categories are probably an ideal number for this kind of design. Any more and we would have to change the navbar to be something like an expandable dropdown to prevent cluttering. You may have also noticed that we have given each of them a unique ID. The importance of this will become more apparent later on when we move to the JavaScript file. But for now, we will focus on styling the markup that we have just created. As you can see, the gallery menu or navbar is display flex, so that we could set it to be spaced between and space the gallery menu items so that they are spread out across the entire width of this container element. They will also be displayed horizontally in a row as well, which is the kind of design that we are aiming for. It is position relative because we will soon be positioning our selector based on this navbar, but more on that later on. And this is the styling for the individual navbar items. They have some padding to move them away from the edges of their flexbox container, and every character will be auto-capitalized via the text transform property. So I'll now right-click and open this markup file with Live Server. Now, Live Server is a very useful dependency, even more so for this project, because it automatically refreshes itself every time I make a change to one of the files that it is hosting on the local server that it creates. This saves us from having to manually press the refresh button every time we want to see what a new change looks like. Instead, we could just hit the save button on VS Code, and then the change will be automatically represented on our local server. And as you can see, we now have the basic structure of the navbar created. What we now need to do is change its styling when the viewport width is too small to fit our navbar's breadth, so as you can see, it's not really responsive at the moment. You might be wondering why we have not decided to just do responsive design in the first place. Where the navbar does not have a fixed width, it is instead based on the viewport's width to prevent an overflow scenario like the one that we currently have. And this is a good question because this method would definitely be less tedious than our current approach, which requires things like media queries and so on. Well, the reason is that we are going to have an animated selector that moves behind the navbar item that is currently selected, and this will not work if we sized our navbar dynamically, because if we did, then it would be impossible to position our navbar selector properly, but more on that later on if it confuses you for now. So the first breakpoint is at 955 pixels, the current width of our navbar. If our viewport has a width less than 955 pixels, but is at least 600 pixels, then this first media query will be met, in which case we will shrink the navbar width to 600 pixels to give us enough room to fit it in the viewport. If, however, our viewport gets even smaller than 600 pixels, then this final media query will be met where we decrease the font size and the width of the navbar to make sure that even the slimmest of devices will be able to display this nav bar in its entirety. And we'll just show this off very quickly. Again, we don't need to refresh because of live server. And as you can see, that's what it looks like at the smallest viewport width. Now it is time to create the selector for the navbar. And we'll create it at the bottom of the gallery menu. In this example, we have set the selector's color to be red, but obviously you can choose whatever color that you want. More importantly, we have set its position to be absolute, meaning it will position itself based on the gallery menu, since that was also positioned with position relative. And as you can see, by default, it is positioned to be with the all selection, because that will be the state of the image gallery on document load. The problem with this is that we cannot see or anymore because it is currently being covered by this selector. The solution is to manually set the text to be above the selector, and we can do that with the setIndex property. And as you can see, we currently have all selected. And because of this, we will set the matching text to be white just to signify that it's selected. Now we will begin the labor's process of manually finding out where we should position the selectors to get each of the menu items selected for all of the three size variations of the menu. I know that this is tedious, but it is the price that you have to pay if you want a design as animated and alive as much as this one. Now that we have the correct width and left offset values for all the different scenarios recorded here, in the order of the left offset first, followed by the width of the selector, we need to create the animation that will begin animating the selector from one of these positions to another one as soon as we click a new gallery option, and we will do this in our JavaScript file. We'll start off by creating references to some of the HTML elements that we will be working with in this file. Next, you will want to create references to all of the individual menu items that the user can click on to configure the gallery images that we want to show. Instead of writing out each one manually, we will instead use the query selector or method on the gallery menu element, because that is the element that every menu item is a child of, to select all of these elements, targeting them by their class. So now gallery menu items will be an array of node elements, and we want to add the same onClick event listener to all of the elements contained in this array. We will do that with this loop to save us from having to do it manually. And this is the method that we will call whenever the user clicks on any of the gallery menu items. The first thing that we will do inside is we will apply transitions to selector, so that instead of just jumping from one position to the next, it will instead animate to its new left and width values from its previous values over a specified period of 1 second. As for how you will move the selector from its previous position to a new position, we will create this function to do that. The first thing that we will do is we will apply the left and width values passed into this function to the selector. Then it will loop through all of the gallery menu items and apply the color white if the ID of the gallery menu item, because remember we gave all of them IDs, if it matches the ID arguments that we passed into the function. We will then use the continue keyword to skip the end of the loop iteration prematurely, to prevent the color black assignment from overwriting this white assignment, because we only want non-selected items to be black. Since we're animating the selector of a transition, we will also give the text the transition to animate its color when the time comes. The actual animation will only last for 0.7 seconds, as it will have a delay of 0.3 seconds, meaning that it will still be aligned with the 1 second duration of the selector's transition. As for what will trigger the animation when the user clicks on one of the gallery menu items, we pass in the ID of the gallery menu item that we clicked on, since that is its unique data on the item that we can use to target that specific item only. As for what will trigger the animation when the user clicks on one of the gallery menu items, that will be handled with this function here. Inside, we will need to have 3 if statements to catch the 3 different media query scenarios that we outlined earlier. This is the first one. It is where our viewport is wide enough to use the default width values that we originally gave our gallery menu. In JavaScript, you could simulate a media query with this match media method on the window object. All we need to do is input the media query in a string that goes inside of this method. And then this matches property will give us a Boolean value related to whether or not we are meeting the media query. Inside, we use a switch statement to set the positions for the four gallery menu items that we have. Again, these values are straight from the comment where you mapped out the position of the selector. Now, if you remember, the first media query had a max width of 955 pixels, and the second was 600 pixels. Therefore, the second media query will share the same max width as the relevant media query in the style sheet, but it will also have this additional query as chained together with the AND keyword. We will set it to be 1 pixel greater than the smallest media query to prevent this if block from being called before the final if block, a necessity because we are using if-else statements, and in if-else statements, only one of the blocks in the sequence can be called. Great, now it shouldn't be too hard to complete this on your own. Remember, the completed project is posted in the description box below, so you can always go there to get the code in full. We can actually close this for now because it's just quite a lot of monotonous code that's just taking up a lot of space. And we will call it in the onClick event handler, passing in the ID of the item that you clicked on as we do. And you made a mistake here, so instead of width, it should be left because we're assigning the left to the left value. So if we go back now, we should be able to see that, yeah, it's transitioning just fine. Problem is, it's not really working because if we do, as you could see on smaller media queries, it's not really working. I mean, it does work for when we actually click on them, but not when we initially transition. So as you can see, that's a problem. To solve this problem, we will create this global scope variable. It will have an assignment value of all by default because that is the ID that is selected automatically on document load. To make sure that it changes in real time whenever we select a new menu item, we will change it to the ID when we do click on one of these gallery menu items. To call code every time the viewport's dimensions are changed, we can listen for the resize event on this window object. And when the event is triggered, we will call the same function as before, the one with the switch statements passing in the global scope variable as we do. Alongside this, we will also remove the transition from the selector because it will look jarring if we animated the navbar on a viewport change. We only want to do this on a deliberate mouse click. Finally, we will need to call this method on initial document load to position the selector in the correct place if we are viewing this website on a slim device. And so now everything should be working as it is as intended. So as you could see, everything's working fine. We can transition, refresh, obviously it's all working good. And then we go to different media queries. And yeah, it's all working as intended. And this is all good. So now that we have the navbar working, it is time to get the main feature, the image gallery. It is now time to start working on that. This is the container that will hold all of the images. It's extremely important that it has relative positioning because all of the child images of this gallery container will be positioned absolutely. And so they will use this position parent element as a reference for their own positioning. If you remember the demonstration at the start, the image gallery had 9 images in total displayed in a 3x3 grid pattern. Therefore, the individual grid items have a width of 33.33% and a height of 33.33% because we want 3 items on both axes, and 33.33 multiplied by 3 isn't quite but close enough to 100% to fit 9 images of equal proportion into a grid of 3 columns and 3 rows. Because of this, each image will have a height of 300 pixels because we fit 3 of them, all of equal proportion, into a container of 900 pixels on both axes. We will also set the transform origin to be center, so when we do scale the images will be scaled by the center point, which is much more natural looking. Now, these gallery item classes will only be div items. The real image elements will be children of these gallery item divs. We want them to match their parents' dimensions and position, and we also want them to cover their parents, so even if the image is not large enough to fit the container, it will proportionately scale itself so that the image is covering the entire container, even if that means clipping some of the image's content in the process. And that's as a result of this object fit property being set to cover. The point of this will probably become clearer later on, but a 3x3 grid will really squish the images together on smaller viewing ports. And in the first media query, we are changing the grid to be a 2x5 grid to fit the 9 images. This is why we changed the width of the items to be 50% and the height to be 20%, because we want their height to be 300 pixels relative to the new height of the container, which is 1,500 pixels. As for the last media query, by that point you want the image to be 1x9, so 9 rows and 1 column to fit the 9 images, so we input these values. As for those 9 images, there is nothing fancy about them. Obviously you could use whatever images that you want to use. For this demonstration, I've just done a quick Google Images search to retrieve some innocuous photos. Now obviously they're not going to be spread out in the grid just yet. To do that, we will need to target each item individually and move them to a unique place in the grid. Whereas at the moment, all of the items are set to be aligned with the top left corner of the container, hence why they all stacked on top of each other in the top left corner here. One thing that we will do before we move on to the JavaScript file is we will set the height of the gallery section to be something more appropriate to the current state of the image gallery. To do this, we will use this calc method because our current image gallery has 3 images in a row and each of them is 300 pixels tall, which makes a total height of 900 pixels. We then add 400 pixels on top of the relevant number of images that we have in the gallery to make room in the section for the header content above the main image gallery and also some extra padding at the bottom. So it now looks like this. So back in our JavaScript file, we will need to create a reference to all of the items in the image gallery, similar to what we did with the image gallery menu with the query selector all method. Then you'll create this function. What it would do is it will take in a list of objects and these objects will target and then change the position of a specific item in the image gallery. Each object in the list will have a num property, which will target a specific element in our gallery container items array. What we are doing here is extracting all of these num properties into an array in the order that we found them in originally. Next, we will loop through all of the elements in the array that contains the 9 images and assign the current image to this variable, providing that the number of the current index is found within our array somewhere. We will extract the object that relates to the element that we are currently looping through. Then we will need to move it to the new position as specified on the associated object. If this isn't initially clear to you, then don't worry. It is hard to explain what is going on here before the actual implementation. I promise you that it will become clear when we actually use this function. If the continue keyword is not met though, then we can safely make the image disappear because we have chosen not to position it, and so it must not be relevant to the chosen category. Because of this, we need to reshow the images if we have previously hidden them but now want them positioned again. Like with the galleries menu, this is the function that will actually get the images moving to their new positions. We will start off with positioning the images when we have a large viewport and the default or option selected. We do this just so we can actually see the images positioned properly for the first time. And let's not forget the fact that we are also configuring the gallery section's height in relation to the number of rows we have in our image gallery, an important feature that we need to get the height animated like how we did in the beginning demonstration. In this case, we are positioning all of the 9 images because this is the all option, and so all of the images must be shown. Take note of how we are positioning them as well. Remember that in this width, our image gallery is 3 rows and 3 columns. Therefore, a left offset starts at 0, increased by 33.33 till 66.66% is reached. Then we go back to 0 to start a new row. A similar thing happens for the rows as well, but you should understand why we're doing this, because 100 divided by 3 is almost 33.33. And we shall call this on initial document loads that the images will be positioned by default. And so now here they are. Obviously, nothing's animated, but they are positioned in that grid-like pattern. We will now fill in all the other options for this specific media query. You may notice that the height for this section is now 300 pixels plus 400 pixels for the rest of the options. This is because for all of the options other than all, we are displaying only one row with three full columns. Since all of our rows are 300 pixels tall, this is the correct height that we now need. Before we can call this function in the onClick event handler, we will create this function to apply the same transition to all of the image gallery items. It will save us a lot of time, trust me. So when we do click on the gallery menu item, this function will be called and this transition will be applied to all of the images, plus a transition on the gallery section to animate its height. And now the animation should be working for this specific media query. As you can see, obviously I know I demonstrated this a lot at the start, so I don't really need to demonstrate it now, but it's working as it was at the start because it's exactly the same. Lastly, we will position all of the elements in relation to the other two media queries. Again, breaking down this monotonous code would take up far too much time in this video. So if you do want to copy what I'm doing, then I suggest you have a look at the completed code as linked in the description box below. Finally, we will do the same as before in terms of how we will also change the positioning when the user resizes the viewport from one media query to the next. And when we do this, we will remove all of the transitions to make the switch easier on the eyes. And so now, if all is going well, we should have completed application. And because we just did what we did here, literally the last thing that we did, it should be working here as well with the different media queries. As you can see, this is the two column version. And obviously, you know, the animations are relevant to the two column version. And then now when we expand, it's relevant to the three column version. And all the images are working just fine. And then the one column version, in my opinion, is well, it's the most interesting anyway, I think, because look at the animation. Again, it's everything just works. I mean, it's kind of a marvel to just look at like how everything just works, and it just does. There's no other way to describe it. I mean, obviously it's quite tedious. It's quite a tedious process. Unfortunately, that's what it takes to do something as eloquent as this. And we now reach the end of the video. I hope you did enjoy this video and I hope you learned something from it. And if you did, I would hugely appreciate it if you did consider liking and subscribing. But anyway, I hope you have a great day and peace out.